Hi, welcome to the Bridge Podcasts. We hope you enjoy the following message. For more information on all that's happening at the Bridge Church, please visit www.bridge-church.com.
I want to share this message today. We've been sharing on purpose, and we've been sharing on providence as well, which has all got to do with purpose and where we end up in life. And I think this morning, as I share the word, I start off in Isaiah 46:10 this morning. The Bible says, declaring the end from the beginning. God is one who knows the end from the beginning. Your history was written before you were born. God knew what the end of you would be. He knew what you would do. So God knows everything. Even before you were born, he declared what you would be and who you would be. And he left the choice to you. He gave us our own free will. We have the choice to the way that we end up. Are you with me? So God declares the end from the beginning, and from the ancient times, things that are not yet done, saying, my cause shall stand and I will do all my pleasure. My counsel shall stand and I will do all of my pleasure. God's counsel will stand and he will do all of his pleasure in your life. You know, it's God's pleasure for you to prosper. It's God's pleasure for you to be in health. It's God's pleasure for you to live out your life strong and well. That's God's pleasure. And he's saying, my counsel shall stand and I will do all of my pleasure. Not just some of it, all of it. And that depends on us. It really depends on us that what pleasure will be done in our life, or how that will be worked out in our life. You know, for 30 years of my life, I went against God. I stood against God, and people would come to me to tell me about the gospel. I say, don't want to hear it. Don't want that God stuff. I don't want to hear anything like that. Please, be gone. And that's the way I was, until one day I succumbed to the gospel, till I gave my life to Jesus. And that was the counsel of God from the beginning, because he knew where I was going to be, but I didn't know where I was going to be. You know, we don't know where we're going to end up until we're walking in his will, plan, and purpose for our life. That's why we've got to renew our minds when we come into the body of Christ, so that our mind can be renewed to his counsel and to his pleasure. So I've entitled this message today, I am determined. I am determined. Are you determined today? You see, for the last 3.7 decades, that's 37 years, I've decided that I would follow Jesus, and I'm determined to accomplish what God has begun in me and to fulfill my purpose. I'm determined. That's why we celebrated the 30th anniversary of the church 2 weeks ago, because the determination of God wasn't to send someone to co-winning so that they could quit after 29 years or 2 years or whatever. No, he wants his counsel and his purpose to be accomplished. So God wants his, he has a determination for every one of you. You may be sitting in a place right now, you say, well, it hasn't worked out in my life. Well, what was your determination? You see, you have a determination, God has a determination, but until you submit your determination to his determination, then it's you and not God. When I gave my life to Jesus, I made him Lord of my life. I made him Lord of all, not Lord of part of it. I made him Lord of all. And that's where I was determined that even although it would cost sacrifice, even although it would cost pain and everything else, even although it would cost me to give up many things, but I was determined because God spoke to me. You see, Paul had a determination in his life in Acts chapter 9 as he rode along the road toward Damascus to persecute Christians. He was determined to persecute Christians until God knocked him off his horse, showed him and gave him an audio visual of who God was. And Paul's determination changed from persecuting Christians to loving Christians, to determined to share the word with as many people as he could. And his word, that the determination he had, is we're still reading today, thousands of years later, because he changed his determination. That's a good word. That's a good word. So we need to change our determinations in life, and to end up where God wants us to end up. In Acts, the book of Acts chapter 2, verse 23, the Bible says, "This Jesus, when delivered up according to the definite and fixed purpose and settled plan and the foreknowledge of God, you crucified and put out of the way, killing him by the hands of lawless and wicked men." You see, when you read that, Jesus was delivered up according to the definite and fixed purpose of his Father, and so that we could come to know the goodness of God, so that we could come to know God's grace, God's mercy, God's compassion, to know that we had a second chance. Amen. Isn't that wonderful? And that was all because of the determined purpose and the definite and fixed purpose and the foreknowledge of God. It was a settled plan. It was a foreknowledge of God. I was thinking of this. You know, you do a lot of thinking when you come to just a few days before your birthday and that sort of thing. You think, it's like the year 2000, the millennium's coming. And I'm thinking, I wonder how long I'll live in the millennium. You know, will I see 2017? Will I see 2020? So you're thinking about these things. And for many years now, I've had a determination at the beginning of every birthday. And my determination is that in my 68th year, I'm going to go out of my 68th year as strong or stronger than I went into it, as healthy or healthier than I went into it. But that doesn't happen, you know, by sitting on a chair thinking, I'm determined that I'll grow my guns or whatever in this next year. No, I've already downloaded the program. This is too much. This is too much for you, I know. But if I don't do that, if I haven't got a structure to where I'm going, if I haven't got a determined plan, I'll go out of this year as a couch potato. We love couch potatoes. Amen? So nothing against couch potatoes. Cadbury's love them. Crisp manufacturers love them. We all love them. But you've got to have a determined purpose. You know, you've got to be determined that you're not going to be. You're going to live until you die and live well until you die. Amen? And live with a mind that you're not vegetating the last years of your life. Amen? I think it's a great, for me, that's my plan anyway. Paul says, imitate me as I imitate Jesus. Acts 2:24 says this, but God raised him up, liberating him from the pangs of death. You see, when we give our life to Jesus, we are liberated from the pangs of death, seeing that it was not possible for him to continue to be controlled or retained by it. You cannot be controlled by the things of death in your life. When you walk according to God's definite plan and fixed purpose for your life, Leviticus says, don't touch the dead things. There's some dead things that we mustn't touch. We don't have dead stuff around you. no vision, no future. It's all, you should be thinking of life in all its fullness. How can I be better for my children? How can I show more love? How can I be more peaceful? How can I be more focused and centered in the things that I do? How can I be more balanced in life? We should be thinking of things that bring life to our life. Are you with me? That's what Jesus couldn't be controlled or retained by death. I minister to old people, and many old people that know Jesus are just looking forward to the day when they'll go and be with Jesus. You see, they're not controlled by death. They have a view. Paul says that he would rather die and be with the Lord, but it's better that I'm here with you so that I can help you to get to the same place that I'm in. Amen. That's what this message is about, and that's what that your purpose is, to get people to the same place that you're in, where you're not controlled by those deadly thoughts, by those thoughts that keep you trapped. Are you with me? So that's where God wants us to go. It says, you see, by the determinant counsel and foreknowledge of God. That's what Acts 2:23 says. And that determinant counsel and foreknowledge of God, God not only foreknew that it would be, but determined that it should be, who does all things after the counsel of his own will, and this for the salvation of his people and for the glorifying of his divine perfections. Through this fixed resolution, settled purpose, and wise determination of God. You see, there's a Greek word, and it's horizio or horizio, maybe that's where we get the word horizon. God has marked out the boundaries and the limits of our lives, and is determined to take us to that place that he's already planned for us. 2 Corinthians 2:6 says, for he says, in an acceptable time I've heard you, and in the day of salvation I've helped you. Behold, now is the acceptable time. Behold, now is the day of salvation. There's times, there's dates God has set on things. I came to know Jesus in January 1980. That was the set time that God had for me. God says it's appointed. Man wants to die, and then the judgment. There's a set time for my death. I will not miss that appointment. None of us will miss that appointment because there's a set time for it. Are you with me? So God has set times in our path, and it's not something to be feared. It's something to look forward to, because he has set times for your increase. He has set time for good things to happen in your life. He's set people for your life. You've got the right people to meet, and you've got the wrong people. You meet the wrong people, you go in the wrong direction. You meet the right people, and you go in the right direction. You meet the wrong people, then you have an opportunity to win them across to the truth. Amen? So, Romans 8:28 says this, we are assured to know that God, being a partner in their labor, all things work together and are fitting into a plan for good to and for those who love God and are called according to his design and purpose. That word together is a Greek word, synergeio. Synergeio means that the Holy Spirit comes into your life. When you ask the Spirit of God to come into your life, he works together with you to accomplish God's pattern, God's design, God's plan, God's determination, God's purpose for your life. The Holy Spirit, it's like a tug of war. He takes hold. In fact, I did this illustration in the other church. I got a big rope and I hid it behind my back and I tied it to a pillar, and I got all these big men to come and get a tug of war with me, and I was on one end of the rope and they were in the other, and when I said pull, of course I could hold them all because one end of the rope was tied to a pillar. You see, and that's like the Holy Ghost. He's pulling together with us against the forces of the world so that we can reach the place that God wants us to be according to his determined purpose for our lives. Amen. You see, he's in it with us. We're not in this journey on our own. Jan said, because God was with me, I could get through the death of my daughter, the death of my two brothers, the death of Ellen, and all of these things. She could get through all of those things because of the synergeo, because of the Holy Ghost pulling with her, pulling her back to that place of the determined plan and will and purpose of God. Amen. Is anybody getting anything from this? God is doing everything he can in our lives. You see, if young people and people with vision or people that want to do something in life could understand that God wants them to get to the place he put the desire in you already, the dream in you that you want to get to, and you can only get it when you've got him pulling along with you to the place that he wants you to be. You see, so instead of you trying all these other things, my granddaughter that's sitting here went for an interview in the uni. There was 400 people there for 100 places. She was offered one of the places. Amen. It's according to his will, plan, and purpose. The Holy Spirit is pulling with you when you yield yourself to his plan and purpose. Amen. Oh, if I could do that Monty Python thing where I lift your brain and put a new engine in. Wow, how good that would be. And it's like God's trying to do that with us. He's trying to just say, open your hearts, open your spirits, open your minds. Just let me in. It's like he's knocking at the door. Somebody says, I saw the devil sitting on the pavement the other day outside a church. I got that wrong. I saw the Holy Spirit sitting outside the church on the pavement. And I said, what's up? He says, I can't get into that church. And it's like he wants us in our, not only in the church, but in our lives. The Holy Spirit in our life leading us. As Isaiah 31, he says, you'll hear a voice from behind you saying, this is the way, walk in it. You see, the greatest achievements I've had in my life are all Holy Spirit-led achievements. Everything has been Holy Spirit-led achievements. Everything. There's not one thing that I could say has not been a Holy Spirit achievement. That the things that I've achieved by not because of my brilliant education or anything like that. No, it was because the Holy Spirit. I was smart enough to yield myself to the will, plan, and purpose of God. Amen? That's as much smarts as you need to yield yourself to him. So, let's move on. Moffat's translation says of Romans 8:28, have his aid and interest in everything. So, God sends the Holy Spirit to aid us, and the interest that he has in us is in everything that we do. He's interested in everything that we do. He's interested in our tough times. He's interested in our block sinks. He's interested in our burst pipes. Oh, Lord, I've got a burst pipe. What do I do? How can you help me? and a name of a plumber comes to mind, or a name of someone that knows a plumber, or something like that. Do you know what I'm saying? He opens your heart and your mind to these things. It just, but ask him. He's interested in everything that we do. Yes. So we trust. What's the best way to drive here? Should I go in the M8? No, you're nuts. Go this way. It takes 3 hours longer to go to Edinburgh now because of the... So it's like, what way is the best way? Amplified Bible says in Colossians 1:29, for this I labor unto weariness, striving with all the superhuman energy which he so mightily enkindles and works within me. I love that. I'm striving with all the superhuman energy that he so mightily enkindled. Oh, I'm so tired, you know. I don't feel like I can do anything. I need 12 hours sleep a day. A little sleep, a little slumber. So shall your poverty come on you like an armed man. I just thought I'd say that. But it's from the Holy Ghost. But the thing is, God gives you supernatural energies so that you can do your purpose, do that which he has determined for you to do. He will accelerate your capacity. He'll give you capacity that you never thought you had. Caleb says, I'm 85 years old, and neither is my eyes dimmed or my strength abated. Amen. My eyes are not dim, nor is my strength abated, but I'm only 85. Give me the land. I'm going to... But Joshua says, there are giants in the land. He says, it doesn't matter. He was Scottish. It doesn't matter. So I'm built for that. Amen? And so that's the kind of thought process. It's like, it's God's plan. He told me I can have it. I can do it. Amen. Glory to God. I'm preaching myself happy. Romans 8:29 says, for those whom he foreknew, this is Amplified Bible, of whom he was aware and loved beforehand, he also destined from the beginning, foreordaining them to be molded into the image of his son. Foreordained them to be molded into the image of his son. So if you're not quite molded into the image of his son, say, Lord, if I'm foreordained, what is obstructing me in my life? What is happening? Why am I not in that image? It's because, and God, the Holy Spirit will say, well, you have to stop watching R-rated movies, or you'll have to... I'll just stop messing now and get back on with the word here. But there's some things in your life that may be stopping you getting to the place, and every one of us knows what those things are. So you deal with those things. And because he's molded us into the image, foreordained us, molded us into the image, and sharing his inwardly his likeness after the pattern that he might become the firstborn among many brethren. The Message Bible says this in 2 Timothy 2:19. Meanwhile, God's firm foundation is as firm as ever, these sentences engraved on the stones. God knows who belongs to him. Spurn evil, all you who name God as God. The love of God, the fear of God, is to hate evil. We've got to hate evil, but love the sinner. Amen? We've got to hate the sin, but love the sinner. We've got to have compassion on the sinner. You were a sinner, lost and undone without Jesus. Paul says in Timothy, of sinners, I was the chief. I was the worst. Some of my family are here and don't speak to them about that. But anyway, I had a yes. So, Paul anyway was the worst. I'm not going to argue with him. Romans 8:30 says, "And those whom he foreordained, he also called, and those whom he called, he also justified, he acquitted, made righteous, putting them into right standing with himself. And those whom he justified, he also glorified, raising them to heavenly dignity and condition or state of being." So if you're in this place and you don't know Jesus, Jesus came to acquit us of sin, to set us free from our past life, and to make us righteous so that we could be the righteousness of God in Christ, so that when God looked upon us, he looked upon us as though it was Jesus he was looking on. So we're as righteous as the Lord Jesus Christ when we submit our life to him, and that we should walk with a heavenly dignity and condition of state and state of being. Church, we need to have that dignity as Christians. We shouldn't. The said of the disciples, they have become an amazement. It looks like they must have been with that Nazarite. They must have been with Jesus, because they could be seen as though there was something different in their life. Amen. So we have to have something different in our life, and that's that heavenly dignity that God calls us to. The beauty of it is the Holy Spirit is drawing us into that place. You won't have that heavenly dignity overnight, but it will come as you're yielded to the Spirit of life in Christ Jesus. Amen. So Romans 8:31 says, "What then shall we say to all this? If God is for us, who can be against us? Who can be against us? Who can be our foe if God is on our side?" Psalm 118 says that the Lord is on my side. I'm not afraid. What can mortals do to me? Mortals can't do anything to you. Words can't do anything to you. We have that old saying, sticks and stones will break my bones, but words will never hurt me. Words can really give you a lot of problems, but if you understand how to overcome the power of words, then and you can bring peace into your life by relying on the Prince of Peace, those words will not cause you stress. They will not cause you to think badly of yourself or anyone else, because you'll be able to overcome words, because nothing can be against us. Amen. Romans 8:32. He who did not withhold or spare even his own son, but gave him up for us all, will he not also with him freely and graciously give us all other things? God wants us to give us all other things. He leaves that to all other things so that we can put what all other things are in that space. Amen? He wants us to have all other things. God wants us to be significant. He wants us to be an amazement. He wants us to be people that know how to do exploits. He wants people to realize that we are able to do over and above all that we can dare ask or think. He wants us to have our dreams so that people will say, let's see what those Christians have got that we haven't got. Amen. Romans 8:33, I'm reading through to 8:38. Who shall bring any charge against God's elect when it is God who justifies, that is, who puts us in right relation to himself? Who puts us in right relation to himself? God does. We can't do it. It's not by works that we are saved, but it's through our reception of God's grace and mercy. He puts us in right relation to himself. Who shall come forward and accuse or impeach those whom God has chosen? Will God, who acquits us? No, God has chosen us and he acquits us. It's like the judge says, the blood has covered their lives. The blood has covered their sin. They are acquitted. There is no charge against them that will be lawful in this court. Case dismissed against them. Hallelujah. Hallelujah, church. I know you're excited. I know I can see it. I feel it. It's in you. You're just bubbling up. That's it. We're acquitted. Amen. So, who is there to condemn us? Well, Christ Jesus, the Messiah who died, or rather who was raised from the dead, who is at the right hand of God actually pleading as he intercedes for us? Jesus seated at the right hand of God. Picture this. Interceding for you. She's really a good woman. He's really a good man. He's really a good daughter. She's really a good daughter. He's really a good son. That's Jesus seated at the right hand of God, interceding for us. Look, don't hold that against them, Father. They didn't understand what they were doing. Forgive them. Amen? Verse 30, who shall ever separate us from Christ's love? Shall suffering and affliction and tribulation or calamity and distress or persecution or hunger or destitution, or peril or sword, even as it is written, for their sake we're put to death all day long, we're regarded and counted as sheep for the slaughter. Yet amid all these things we are more than conquerors and gain a surpassing victory through him who loved us. For I am persuaded, verse 38, beyond doubt, I'm sure that neither death nor life nor angels nor principalities nor things impending and threatening nor thing to come nor powers. Amen. I'm fully persuaded. I am determined. I am fully persuaded that according to God's definite plan and purpose, nothing shall separate me from the love of Christ. One day when I leave this earth, I'm going to be straight into heaven. And it's not going to be a problem. There's going to be no fear. I'm going to a place where there's no more sighing, crying, or dying. I'm going to a place where I'll have a new body, a body that's already prepared for me. You look forward to that. Amen. When you understand the love of God. Romans 8:39 says, nor height, nor depth, nor anything else in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God, which is in Christ Jesus our Lord. So we have these promises for us, and God is determined to take us as a church to the place where he has called us to be. He called us to bring a message of faith, hope, and love. He called us to bring a message of liberation to the captives. He sent us and me and you to set the captives free, to proclaim liberty to the captives, to pray for the lame that they would walk, for the blind that they would see, and for the poor so that they would be released from the power of poverty. That's us. We came to prepare people with a message of liberation. Amen. And that's, I'm determined until I die, that's what I'll be doing. I'll be proclaiming God's goodness. Amen. No matter where I am in the world at that time, I'll be proclaiming God's goodness. The Good News Bible says this in Ephesians 1:11, all things are done according to God's plan and decision, and God chose us to be his own people in union with Christ because of his own purpose, based on what he had decided from the very beginning, being predestinated according to the purpose of him who works all things after the counsel of his own will. Predestination is not only to sonship, but to an inheritance. It not only secures the grace of adoption, but prepares and provides a heavenly portion. And this act of predestination proceeds according to a purpose, according to the purpose of God, which can never be frustrated. So we have a predestined purpose. We have a predestined end. We're We're part of an inheritance, and we are adopted into his forever family, church.
Thanks for listening. Remember to visit our website, www.bridge-church.com, and connect with us via Facebook and Twitter.